Come on, let's praise God. How many are ready for the word of the Lord? Hallelujah. As we stated, this is our clergy appreciation month. And every week we've been going higher and higher and higher in the word. And I'm so excited about the preachers that we have who are sharing the gospel here at Purpose Church. Listen, if you come to Purpose Church and you say you've been called by God, amen. Number one, it's between you and God. But then I'm going to make sure that you do what God has called you to do. Amen. All my ministers can say amen to that. Amen. If you say you've been called by God, of course, I'm going to pray about it. I'm going to use the spirit of discernment. But then I'm going to test your faith. I'm going to test your faith to make sure, amen, that this is what God has called you to do. And this morning we have to bring the word with us, our assistant pastor, amen, of Purpose Church. She's no stranger. She's been with us these last almost 10 years since the relaunch of our church. Amen. Let's receive the word of God by way of our assistant pastor, minister, assistant pastor Yolanda Simmons Battle. Come on, let's give God praise.
Amen. This is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. It didn't say let I rejoice or me or just you. It said let us rejoice and be glad in it. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. You all can take your seats. I am so grateful to be here, that our pastors, Leandra and Patricia Hill, share the altar. Now, we've heard of some ministries where there are many ministers and they do not get the opportunity to share the word that God has placed inside of them. So we are fortunate here. We are blessed for this opportunity that we are poured into, and then we get to express and share our assignment. So I want us to honor our pastors for this opportunity. So Pastor Leandra and Patricia Hill for their vision, their leadership, and for teaching us and being an awesome example. Amen, amen. Well, I heard of a story of a great football coach. Now, because some of you who know, my beloved is a true sports fan. So because he is a true sports fan, I am a sports fan by proxy. I have become a sports fan as well. So there's this wonderful story of a great football coach, and he took on the job of the head coaching job after this team had only won two little old measly games in the previous season. They didn't even win by a big blowout either. It was barely made it and they won. Not a lot of people was interested in coaching this team, but this person, this young man, he came and he saw that he had his work cut out for him. He didn't flinch at the assignment and he took the job. At the meeting, with the first meeting with the team, he gathered them all together. They sat down and he said, he held up an object in his hand and he said, "This, my friends, is a football." Now, this team had been playing for years ahead, and every season they had been pretty bleak. But this man came in and said, "This, my friends, is a football." I want you to hold on to that. In this season of open doors and opportunities, there's a need to feel, to be innovative, to be creative, to launch out into the deep and get ready for the new. And all these things are true. But so many of us have experienced, or is now in the present tense, experiencing a feeling of being stuck. A feeling of not knowing what to do next. The pressure of feeling like I gotta do something great and magnificent. These past 18 months or so has pushed us to reevaluate where we are, where we've been, what are we doing? At least that's what the culture has been telling us. That's what the narrative that's been flying around on the social media, that we should be having these great ideas and birthing new things and coming up with new ideas. And I'm not saying that's not true. But what if we are stuck in the sandbox, in the quicksand? If I can be honest, I felt that way. And maybe somebody is feeling that right now. Maybe you feel it, I don't know where to start. What is this pause has supposed to been revealing to me? Am I not living up to my full potential? Have I failed? But don't sit this season out. Just as the coach that I spoke of in the beginning of the trouble football squad, he didn't berate them, he didn't down them, he didn't ask them what their problem was, he didn't say, what were you all doing, what were you all thinking, he just went back to the basics. This, my friends, is a football. So in our season to help us get us moving and towards the new and being in preparation for the open doors and the opportunities, when it's time for us to move, maybe we need to do a little bit of review of getting back to the basics. Go with me to Psalms 34, starting at the first verse. I love David, who was the author of the Psalms, of many Psalms. Boy, 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 when you get a time, just research about David himself. He was an awesome man of God who loved God. Who he had his flaws, who he showed it. But he loved God and he knew how to worship him. Okay, y'all ready? Psalms 34. I will bless the Lord at all times. His praise shall continually be in my mouth. My soul makes its boast in the Lord. The humble and downtrodden will hear it and rejoice. Oh, magnify the Lord with me, and let us lift up his name together. I sought the Lord, and he answered me and delivered me from all my fears. This was David's exhortation to God when he was on the run, when he was pretending to be insane, running from Amalek. I don't know why he chose to go crazy, but you know, that's another sermon for another day. And Amalek didn't want to have to deal with somebody who was acting crazy and being insane and not knowing what they was talking about and foaming at the mouth and saying words that just didn't make sense. David was a person who knew when and where and how to worship God. Even in his distress, he knew this was the time to praise the Father. So if we look about where we are now, living in this pandemic, deeply divided country that we're living in, people fighting, if you say black, they say white, you say blue, they say purple, and you ready to fight. This is the time to praise God. while we are in position and anticipation of our open doors and opportunities, when we are ready to walk through the door, when we are ready to receive that open opportunity, we are already in a position of praise. So this leads me to my first point. Remember your first love. Do you remember when you first believed? Do you remember that day, that time, that night, that evening, that moment when you believed and realized that Jesus was the Son of God and he would walk the earth and he was born and died just for you? Do you remember how excited and how zealous you were? You couldn't wait to tell everybody how saved you were. You was praying without ceasing. As people asked you how you were doing, I'm blessed and highly favored. You remember how you were? Everything that came out your mouth was a moment of praise. You couldn't wait to tell people about God. You worship. You had the gospel station on repeat in your car. You didn't run alerts. I'm not listening to that worldly music no more. You know, you were super saved. You was at home singing praises at church. You were the first one there, the last one to leave. Come on, that's another sermon. You was in your car. You was with your family. You couldn't wait to talk about the goodness of God. What happened? Revelations 2, starting at verse 2. I know your deeds and your toil and your patient endurance, and that you cannot tolerate those who are evil and have tested and critically appraised those who call themselves apostles and in fact are not, and have found them to be liars and imposters. And I know you believe you are enduring patiently and are bearing up for my name's sake, and that you have not grown weary of being faithful to the truth. But I have this charge against you, that you have left your first love. What happened when you first knew him? What happened to the joy, the energy, the excitement? We couldn't wait to read our word. We've become very lethargic in our behavior, lazy in our prayer life, complacent in our reading of the word. We must ask God to help light the fire that has fizzled out. Do you remember? Point number two, remember that God has done it before. He will do it again. So getting back to the basics is getting back to your remembrance of the things that God has already done for you. My Trippie had a song that said, if he did it before, he'll do it again. He is the same God. So if you remembered and you was excited when he healed you 3 years ago, what makes you think he's not going to heal you and you cannot get excited right now as you anticipate your healing right now? Getting back to the basics. If you read the story of the crossing of the children of Israel in Exodus 14, and we see that God had promised the children the promised land. They had seen God's power with their own eyes. They had experienced it. They saw the Red Sea depart and dry land was under it, and they were able to cross and make it away across from the Egyptians, and they saw with their own eyes The sea closed up behind them and swallowed up the Egyptians. What happened to believing and remembering that he's the same God? If he protected you from the Egyptians 5 years ago, what makes you think he's not going to protect you from the Egyptians in 2021? What is your Egyptian in your life right now? Do you think God will not open up that door for you? He opened up the Red Sea. Why wouldn't he open up a door or open up a window or give you an opportunity that's laying right before you? He's done it before. He'll do it again. He is the same God. We have to get back to the basics of remembering how great he is. God has protected us from danger seen and unseen. Not because we're so cute, but because he is God. We out here thinking and wobbling and worried and shrinking and I don't know if this is going to happen for me. Why? Straighten up your back. Hold your head up high. Go to God with some authority like you did before when you first believed. I believe God will do it for me because he's done it before. Sometimes the goodness of God begins to feel like second nature. We begin to take God for granted. So, because we take God for granted, we don't revel in his love and his goodness and his mercy. The zeal has gone out because we're like, oh, he's done that already. We cannot get rested on our laurels and get complacent and feel like that, oh, this happens all the time. That removes us from the excitement and the intimacy that we are supposed to have with God our Father. We have to get back to being in a position of praise is what we do. It's what we do, even when I'm going through. I lift my hands in praise because praise is who I am. Getting back to the basics. Point number three. I know I'm moving through. I'm moving. But it don't take all day to recognize sunshine. Ain't that a common song? All right. Here we go. Communing with God. Point number three. Getting back to the basic of communing with God. When the last time you had a conversation with God? I mean, for real. I mean, like you do when you're talking to your girlfriend, your homie, your boy, I don't know what terms that the young folks is using, but when the last time you sat down, not while you rushing, cooking, oh, Father, I stretch my hand to thee and let me stir these peas. Like, when the last time you actually sat down and committed to a conversation with the Lord? So you all know I like to look up definitions. Communication means the imparting or exchanging of information or news. Exchange. So that's a two-way thing. So we just can't sit and just. Now we gotta sit and listen. And I say you have to commune with God with all of your senses. Your ears, your eyes, what you feel in your spirit, sometimes what you may taste and what you smell. When the last time you actually commune with God? When did you feel God's presence? When we commune with God, we get our orders aligned for what he wants us to do as it pertains to our assignments. See, give us the marching orders And then sometimes we got to go back and get the instructions that go with the marching orders. What do you want me to do with said assignment? How should I operate? How should I move? How should I progress? Am I moving in the right way? So you can't do that if you're sitting there and you're listening to V103 and you're trying to commune with God. I'm not saying don't listen to the radio. I'm just saying priorities. Okay? Don't go up and say, Yolanda said, don't listen to the radio. That's not what I say. Okay? All right. When we commune with God, we also should sit in his presence. I mean, sit in it. Okay? With all of our questions, all of our concerns, all of our hurt. All of our joy. All of our confusion, all of our confidence, all of our wants, all of our needs, all of our desires. The intimacy with the Father, that aligns with communion with him. Communion with God is a basic function of a relationship with him. Think about the relationships that you have. If you don't talk to a person, that relationship kind of dwindle down. If it's one way, if that person's always calling you, you don't call them, or you don't text them, or you don't send a bird to say, hey, I was thinking about you. It's a one-way relationship. That's the same with God. It is important that we not just sit up here and say we love God, but we have to act it out. In worship, and when we sing praises unto him, and when we sit and listen to him. See, David, he knew how to commune with God. He was on the run. He was like, magnify the Lord with me. Thank you, Lord. David knew how to commune with God. David danced so hard that he danced out of his clothes one time. They was looking at him like, what is wrong with him? But David didn't care about what other people were saying. Don't worry about what your homies are saying and those who are on the fringes and may be talking about you and say, oh, you look weird. Why are you doing that? Why are you spending so much time in prayer? Because you don't know what God has laid before me and what I need to prepare for. Minister Redmond said something to us yesterday that confirmed something that we have been talking about. Sometimes you can't take your crew with you. Okay? He said that and we were all like, what? Right there. Because it confirmed what I had been studying. A lot of times that we want to take everybody with us. This social media culture has disturbed us because we want to have how many likes did we get? How many people commented on us? How many people said something and asked us a question about what we were doing instead of understanding what did God like about what we have done? How many likes did God give you? We so worried about what the outside people are saying instead of asking, am I living my life that's representative of the kingdom that's going to draw somebody to the Lord? Psalms, the book of Psalms, there's 150 books in the book of Psalms, 150 chapters. 150 chapters of worship, praise, and adoration to God. So if you ever need a little help, just go there. Give you that jolt that you need and represent and give you, David has laid the foundation of how we can follow to worship and praise God. Before you can move on with a new project or build off what you already have, we need to remember the basic function of that item or that process. Think about it in this sense. Before you can learn trigonometry, you have to know the basics of algebra and geometry. Before you learn algebra and geometry, it's beneficial to have simple addition and subtraction. So before we can move into a more intimate realm in the kingdom, we have to get back to the basic of remembering our first love, knowing how to commune with God, and remembering that He done it before, He will do it again. Abraham knew how to commune with God. In Genesis chapter 18, verse 32 and 33, Abraham said, "Oh, may the Lord not be angry with me. And I will speak only this once. Suppose 10 people are found there." And he said, "I will not destroy it for the sake of the 10. As soon as he had finished speaking with Abraham, the Lord departed, and Abraham returned to his own place. So this is the story about when Abraham had the concern about Sodom and Gomorrah. And the three people came, I'm using quotation marks, because when you read this chapter, you'll realize that the people then were angels, and one of them was God. Abraham had a relationship that he knew exactly who to talk to. He didn't talk to the other two. His heart knew and zoomed in. Oh, that's God the Father. And he spoke to him with an urgency and a care. And went right to God with his request. Going back to the basics does not mean that you're going backwards. Okay? I want to make this clear. Going back to the basics does not mean you are going backwards, that you are now drinking milk when you were once eating solid foods. It means that you are acknowledging the need for your own revival, your own rebirth, and your own review of the manual that God has instilled in you. Sometimes we just need a refreshing. Understanding your review period, just like before you take a test, you should review the material before you go into the exam room. It is time for preparation to be able to receive all that God has done for us. We cannot receive because we got our hands closed and we're too scared to open up the book, the Bible, and read what He has already given unto us and doing what He has told us to do. When the Bears won last Sunday, they went to practice. And when they went back to practice, they did some running around the field. They just run. Basic calisthenics. Basic tossing the ball. Catch it. Toss it. Back. Now, they won last Sunday. Now, why would Nagy have them doing the same little basic exercises? It's a review period. I need to get you ready for the next, because their next opponent is strong and mighty. So let's get to the basics. Get your nervousness down. Let's get your focus back, not on your opponent, the Green Bay Packers, but get you ready for the job that you already know that you need to do. Getting back to the basics. You know the coach I spoke of at the beginning, who took over the team after they only won 2 games in the previous season? Well, for those who may not know, that was the great Vincent Thomas Lombardi, who took his place with the first meeting with the Green Bay Packers in 1959. He helped lead that team to 3 straight and 5 total league championships in 7 years, leading that team to the first and second NFL Super Bowls. So when God instructs you to get back to the basics, don't fret. Do not be encouraged. He is setting you up for your own Super Bowl. He is getting you ready for your own playoff game. It is time for the finale. Time to get back to basic training. Time to do a review of the manual and get back into God's word. Time to study. Get back to understanding and taking notes and asking questions and doing some research and sitting down in God's presence, asking him what it is that you need me to do in this season. I am ready to take on the assignment. I'm ready because I know this here is a football, and my football is the Bible, and I'm ready to take on the word and really get into what I have need to do for my next steps. Am I gonna run and play on the Super Bowl? Yes, I am. It's my own Super Bowl. I'm so excited. Get ready for the assignment that God has for you. What is your Super Bowl? Is it your playoff time? Is it the tournament time? Get ready. Get ready. Get ready. Get ready. As Pastor Pat always tells us, the unbelievers are watching. So what are the unbelievers seeing in you? Are they seeing you complacent? Are they seeing you crowded up, scared? Or are they seeing you with your standing tall and reading your word and praying without ceasing and singing songs of praise and getting ready for the battle? Are your arms open up and your hands open, ready to receive praise? Or are you in fear of what's to come? Jeremiah 29:11 says, "For I know the plans I have for you, declares the Lord. Plans to prosper you and not to harm you. Plans to give you hope and a future." That's what getting ready for your open door and opportunity is. God already knew it. It's already laid out. And it's already planned. We just got to get back to the basics. To be ready. To be in position. And to not be afraid. Amen. Come on, are you ready for your own Super Bowl? Are you ready to get back to the basics? Are you ready for prayer? Are you ready to receive what God has for you? Amen. God is an awesome God. He's a great God. And if you have been out of the ark of safety, and you know that Jesus was born, he lived, walked the earth, taught, ministered, and died for your sins. It's time to come back. Time to come back. And all you have to do is just believe. And believe in your heart and in your mind that he died for you. So you may have eternal life with him and God the Father. May you take the word that you heard on today and don't be selfish with the word. But share with someone else. And if it's something that you didn't understand, do your own research. Get back to the basics of loving God, worshiping God, communing with God, remembering your first love, and knowing that he did it before. He's not going to leave you now. Why would he? He got more things in store. For all of us, so many things in store. So he's not going to leave us nor forsake us. Amen.
Come on, let's give God praise for the word of God. How many know that we all need to go back to the basics? We need to get back to worshiping, serving, and giving. and giving God glory. Let's give God praise for the woman of God and the word of God. Amen. As it has been shared. Amen. We thank God for her and for the preached word of Jesus Christ. Listen, we all got something that we got to get back to. We got to readjust ourselves, realign ourselves. This pandemic has got many of us out of whack. Amen. Out of whack and out of the way. And we need to shift ourselves back into the right posture and presence of God. Amen. Want to announce real quick on next Sunday, Pastor Pat has instructed me and we will wear pink for breast cancer awareness on next Sunday. We do this every single year around this time. We don't want to miss this opportunity. And so we want to encourage you all to come in representation. Amen. As we remember those who are either living with or has succumbed to this issue of breast cancer and all of those things. And there's so many other issues around the world, but we want to take the opportunity to continue to do what we do to bring awareness to good health, amen, and good living, and to remember other people as well. And so she's asking everyone, even the fellas, you can wear pink. They got pink bear stuff too, don't they? I ain't gonna wear one, but they got it. I'm gonna wear something pink, but it's not gonna be a pink. I went to the game last week. They gave us a pink bear. I'm gonna bring my pink Bears towel from the game last other week I went to, and I'm gonna tuck it in my thing right there. How about that? It's gonna be pink, and I'm gonna say "Go Bears" with a deep voice. Y'all'll get that later. Amen. Amen. Listen, if you can find a way to be a blessing to the speaker on today, either put something in her hand or we'll get her given information. And you can give to her as well. Listen, on next week, our youth pastor is speaking. Amen. Minister Daryl Redman, our youth pastor. Amen. I'm not even coming because he preached yesterday at breakfast. So I got my word. So I'm not even coming on next because he already preached at breakfast on yesterday. So I got a whole word for the rest of the year from our youth pastor. So I want to encourage you all to come next week as our youth pastor speak. Then I want to encourage you, bring your kids to church. Amen. Get them up out the bed. Amen. Get your kids up out the bed. Matter of fact, hold on. You get up out the bed. Amen. To come on to church at least once a month. Let us see your face. Those who don't come into the place, let us see your face at least once a month. Listen, before we go, help me celebrate Leonard, who is back. Amen. Leonard has been on tour. I'm jealous. He's been on tour. He's been to California, Texas, Dubois. That's how you pronounce it, Dubois. He been over there. He been gone. He been everywhere. He's been all around the world, Utah and mountains and playing saxophone in mountains and everything else. He's been there. And we thank God for him and we thank God for his gift. And the fact that he did all that and came right back to church. Y'all hear me? He did all that with his gift, then brought his gift right back to church. And guess what? The whole time he was gone, guess what he was doing? Every stop he made, he was tithing and giving. Every city he went to and got blessed, he was tithing and giving all the way around the world. And so we celebrate him. We thank God for his gift. I'm going to learn how to play something so I can go with him next time. Let's stand all over the building. Amen. Amen. At 11 a.m., I'll be preaching at the Original Providence Church, 515 North Pine. If you want a little bit more church, you can come hang out with your pastor. But as Redman already said, I don't even need a whole crew with me. I just got to go do what God told me to do. Amen. Come on, lift your hands. God, we thank you for the woman of God who has preached your word. God, we pray now that you will refill her as she goes to her next preaching assignment on this morning. We pray, God, that you will continue to give her the word for the people over at Cathedral Baptist Church on the south side of Chicago. Touch her and keep her, God. Bless her family. Bless her children. Bless her husband. Bless all who are connected to her, oh God. Now bless us, your people. Bless the Three Crosses of Calvary as they now prepare to worship. We pray for the man of God who will preach your word at the next worship service in this space. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. Go in peace. See you Wednesday online at 7 p.m.